So let me ask you a question as always. Why do businesses borrow money? Any one of you? Why do businesses borrow money?
Operate and to expand.
Okay, very good. Very good. Yes, what else? Is it possible to increase EPS? And all of you know what is EPS? Earning per share. Earning per share. So the net profit of the company divided by the number of shares is your EPS, earning per share. Is it possible to increase EPS of a company without any change in the operating profit? And the answer is yes. It is possible to increase earning per share of a company without increasing the operating profit. And how will that happen? Again, let us understand it with the help of an example. So this case is also given in your workbook. And please understand, earning per share is a very, very crucial and critical number for all the top managements of all the corporates across the globe. Earning per share, EPS. And why it is critical and crucial? Because all of you, those of you who are interested in the share market, you will know when the earning per share of a company increases, the market price of that company's share also increases on the stock market. And if the market price of a company's share increases on the stock market, by default, wealth of the shareholders increases. So let's say, for example, I am holding 100 shares of Reliance, and Reliance is today 2000 rupees. So what is my wealth? My wealth is 2000 of Reliance shares into 100. 2000 rupees, the market price today, into 100. So my wealth is 2 lakh rupees. Tomorrow, the EPS of Reliance increases substantially. As a result of that, the market price of Reliance's share goes to 2500 rupees. Now, what is the value of my investment? Now, the value of my investment is 250,000, 2.5 lakh rupees, 2.5 lakh rupees is the wealth, my wealth as an investor. That is the significance of earning per share. And that is why corporates across the globe are always focusing on how to increase the earning per share. Because as they increase earning per share of a company, by default, wealth of the shareholders automatically increases. Let us understand how do companies make use of financial leverage? How companies make use of borrowing for increasing benefit for the shareholders? So, एक छोटा सा example है. There is a capex proposal, extremely profitable, with the certainty of 30% ROI, यानी कि 30% return on investment की guarantee है. No operational risk. Project cost is $300 million. उसकी PBIT, यानी कि ऑपरेटिंग प्रॉफिट इज $90 million. सो आई एम श्योर यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड, $300 million इज द इन्वेस्टमेंट, 30% इज द ROI. सो 30% ऑफ $300 million इज $90 million. सो द ऑपरेटिंग प्रॉफिट इज $90 million ऑफ दिस कंपनी. एंड माई क्वेश्चन इज इट पॉसिबल टू इंक्रीज अर्निंग पर शेयर ऑफ दिस कंपनी विदाउट any increase in this operating profit of $90 million. Okay, that is the question that we are discussing. Tax rate, we are assuming it to be 40%. Debt is available at 100% and at the rate of 10%. So agar aap borrow karna chahte hain, if you want to borrow money, then you can borrow at the rate of 10%. Face value of every share is $1. So in case the company issues a new share, it is the face value is going to be $1. अब ये जो पर्सन हैं जो बिजनेस चालू कर रहे हैं, उनके पास में इसको फंडिंग के तीन ऑप्शन हैं. पहला ऑप्शन ये है कि 100% एक्विटी डालें, यानी कि 300 करोड़ का प्रोजेक्ट है, 300 करोड़ अपनी जेब में से डाल दें एज एक्विटी शेयर कैपिटल. दूसरा ऑप्शन ये है कि 50% एक्विटी अपनी जेब से डालें और 50% एक्विटी शेयर अपने फ्रेंड्स को बोलेंगे भाई अच्छा प्रोजेक्ट है, मौका बढ़िया है, तू भी हिस्सा ले ले और तू भी डाल दे, तू भी थोड़ा फायदे में रहेगा। तीसरा ऑप्शन ये है टू फंड दिस प्रोजेक्ट इन द डेट इक्विटी रेशियो ऑफ 2:1। डेट इक्विटी रेशियो ऑफ 2:1 का मतलब क्या है, 300 करोड़ का प्रोजेक्ट कॉस्ट है, 200 करोड़ लोन ले लो और 100 करोड़ इक्विटी करके डालो अपनी जेब से। सो ये तीन इनके पास में इसको फंडिंग के ऑप्शंस हैं, है ना। तो पहले दो ऑप्शंस में इक्विटी है, तीसरा जो ऑप्शन है उसमें डेट का इस्तेमाल किया है, डेट यानी कि लेवरेज का इस्तेमाल किया है, यानी कि फाइनेंशियल लेवरेज का इस्तेमाल किया है। अब हमको ये समझना है फाइनेंशियल लेवरेज से कि फाइनेंशियल लेवरेज का इस्तेमाल करके क्या बेनिफिट्स होते हैं। सो लेट मी नाउ टेक यू टू द एक्सेल शीट वंस अगेन। We are almost done, just about 10 more minutes. Are you able to see it on your screen, everyone? Gajanan?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. So, अब देखिए तीन options हैं of funding के। Project cost के project, what is the project cost? It is $300 million. In all three cases, so there is no difference. I'm just going to copy it. Equity share capital. अगर पहले जो पहला जो proposal उसमें क्या है कि the owner wants to put 100% equity from his pocket, तो ये 300 आ गया. In the second one, what is the option? Second one, the option is promoter के पास में पैसा नहीं है, तो 150 equity वो अपनी जेब से डालेगा, 150 की equity वो friends को डालने के लिए बोलेगा. सो इवन देन इट इज एक्विटी ओनली। सो यहाँ पे भी 300 हो गया। नाउ व्हाट इज द सेकंड थर्ड ऑप्शन? थर्ड ऑप्शन डेट इक्विटी रेशियो ऑफ 2:1, यानी कि 100 मिलियन डॉलर्स की इक्विटी और 200 मिलियन डॉलर्स का डेट। अभी हमने सुना पहले कि फेस वैल्यू कितनी है, 1 रुपए की है। सो अगर 300 मिलियन डॉलर्स इज द अमाउंट ऑफ इक्विटी, the number of shares also will be $300 million only. क्यों? क्योंकि face value is 1. And how many shares will be here? $100 million shares. यहाँ पर loan लिया है जिसके ऊपर 10% का interest भरना है। Operating profit कितना है? आप सभी को मालूम है operating profit is $90 million, जो कि हमने discuss किया already. अब यहाँ पर interest आएगा क्या पहले वाले केस में? Interest नहीं आएगा। क्यों? लोन नहीं लिया है, डेट नहीं है, तो इंटरेस्ट नहीं आएगा। सेकंड वाले केस में इंटरेस्ट आएगा, सेकंड वाले केस में भी इंटरेस्ट नहीं आएगा, क्योंकि उधर भी एक इक्विटी है, वो दोनों ने, दोस्त ने और ओनर ने मिलकर इक्विटी डाली है। सो देयर इज नो इंटरेस्ट हेयर ऑल्सो। नाउ विल देयर बी इंटरेस्ट हेयर? यस, देयर विल बी एन इंटरेस्ट हेयर। वाई? बिकॉज दिस प्रपोजल हैज कंसिडर्ड अ लोन ऑफ $200 मिलियन, रेट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट इज 10%, सो हेयर द इंटरेस्ट इज गोइंग टू बी $20 मिलियन। अब पीबीटी कितना हो जाएगा? यू कैन कॉल इट पीबीटी और यू कैन कॉल इट ईबीटी, बोथ मीन्स सेम थिंग। पीबीटी इज प्रॉफिट बिफोर टैक्स, ईबीटी इज अर्निंग बिफोर टैक्स, बोथ मीन द सेम थिंग। एंड लाइकवाइज हियर आल्सो यू कैन कॉल इट पीएटी और यू कैन कॉल इट ईएटी। पीएटी इज प्रॉफिट आफ्टर टैक्स, ईएटी इज अर्निंग आफ्टर टैक्स। सो नाउ पीबीटी कितना हो गया? यहाँ पे पीबीटी विल बी सेम बिकॉज देयर इज नो इंटरेस्ट कॉस्ट, and same is the case in the second one also. And but in the third case, what is going to happen is your PBT is going to be lesser because interest cost hai. So PBT or EBT will be 70. Tax ka rate 40% hai. So how much will be the tax here? Tax in the first case will be going to be $36 million. Same is the case in the second one, but in the third case the tax is going to be $28 million. So how much the EAT? EAT in this case is EBT minus the tax. So this is the EAT here, earning after tax, and it is 42 in case of the last one. EPS kitna hoga? And this is where you should need to pay attention. EPS in this case is going to be 54 divided by 300, and in this case second one also is going to be same, and in the third one it is going to be 0.42. So you can see, and how much will be the return on equity? The return on equity is going to be 54 divided by the equity, which is 18%, and here also 18%. But in case jahan pe aapne loan liya hai, your return on equity is going to be 42. Your return on equity is going to be 42. Now I'm sure, friends, it is very clear to every one of us. When in both these options, I'm funding it by way of equity. I'm not using debt. I'm not using financial leverage. So when I'm not using financial leverage, my earning per share is 0.18. And when I'm using leverage, my earning per share is coming 4. My earning per share is coming 0.42. That means what? I'm sure you can very clearly see, when I'm borrowing, I'm able to increase my earning per share. When I'm borrowing, I'm able to increase my earning per share. And we understand, when the earning per share is higher, the market price of the share is also higher. And when the market price of the company share is higher, automatically the wealth of the shareholder is also higher. And that is, friends, your financial leverage. अब एक सवाल जो आपके दिमाग में आना चाहिए और आ रहा होगा कि ये कैसे हो गया. अब देखिए ये क्यों हो गया, क्योंकि ये जो प्रोजेक्ट है इसका जो ROI है वो 30% है. एंड प्लीज पे अटेंशन, इसका जो प्रोजेक्ट है, ये प्रोजेक्ट का ROI 30% है. और आपने लोन कितने रेट से लिया है? लोन जब थर्ड जो प्रपोजल है प्लान सी में, लोन यू हैव टेकन एज 10%. दैट मीन्स वॉट? That means this ROI is 30% and your loan that you have taken is at the rate of 10%. So the difference, the 20% ka jo benefit, hai, that benefit is accruing to the shareholders. That benefit is accruing to the shareholders. And that is the reason why the earning per share is increasing. One more reason, thoda complex hai, lekin aapko bata deta hun. One more reason is, dekho, aapne dekha ye C mein, टैक्स 28 रह गया, जबकि ए और बी में टैक्स 36 है. ये टैक्स यहां पर कम क्यों हो गया? ये टैक्स यहां पर इसलिए कम हो गया बिकॉज इन बिजनेस व्हेन यू बोरो यू पे इंटरेस्ट, एंड व्हेन यू पे इंटरेस्ट, एज यू कैन सी हियर, यू सेव ऑन टैक्स. एंड द टैक्स विच यू आर सेविंग इज फॉर हूज बेनिफिट? इट इज फॉर द बेनिफिट ऑफ द शेयर होल्डर. एंड दैट इज हाउ the operating leverage works. So this is, friends, your operating leverage. And very quickly, let me also share with you what are the benefits of using the financial leverage very quickly, and then we'll come to the last topic, that is GST. Please go ahead.
Sir, if it is not a earning per share, then option A and B is safer. Agar hum earning per share pe calculate hi nahi kare, to it means we get a more profit.
Shishir, देखो, इसे देखो, ultimately आप business में आपका पैसा लगा रहे हो, है ना? अब आप अगर पैसा लगा रहे हो तो विल यू लाइक टू अर्न मोर प्रॉफिट ऑन योर इन्वेस्टमेंट, और विल यू लाइक टू अर्न लेस प्रॉफिट ऑन योर इन्वेस्टमेंट? एंड अर्निंग पर शेयर, रिमेंबर, इज द प्राइम इंडिकेटर ऑफ योर रिटर्न ऑन योर इन्वेस्टमेंट. सो ए और बी में प्रॉफिट ज्यादा दिख, पीएटी ज्यादा दिख रहा है, लेकिन इन टर्म्स ऑफ योर इन्वेस्टमेंट इट इज मच लेस देन व्हाट इट इज इन केस ऑफ प्लान सी. सो ईपीएस तो आपको ध्यान में रखना ही होगा, बिकॉज अल्टीमेटली आई एम पुटिंग माय मनी इनटू बिजनेस बिकॉज आई वांट टू अर्न एज मच एज पॉसिबल. एंड व्हाट इज द इंडिकेटर फॉर मी? इट इज अर्निंग पर शेयर. Yeah, okay, good. So let's now the what are the benefits? Just what are the benefits of the borrowing? And please let's quickly spend a minute. अब आप देख सकते हो कि रीजन्स वाई पीपल बोरो 100% कंट्रोल विद 1/3 इन्वेस्टमेंट, यस और नो शिशिर? 100% कंट्रोल विद 1/3 इन्वेस्टमेंट
यस
की,
सर,
नंबर वन. नंबर टू, अनलॉकिंग ऑफ $200 मिलियन फॉर अदर प्रोजेक्ट्स. नाउ ये प्रोजेक्ट में मैंने $100 मिलियन लगा के पूरा कंट्रोल मेरे हाथ में ले लिया, $200 मिलियन मेरे फ्री हो गए जो कि मैं किसी और प्रोजेक्ट में लगा सकता हूँ. कंट्रोल ऑन 3 कंपनीज इंस्टेड ऑफ वन, $300 मिलियन एक ही कंपनी में लगा दिए, एक ही कंपनी पे कंट्रोल रहेगा. $300 मिलियन, $100 मिलियन, $100 मिलियन, $100 मिलियन, 3 कंपनियों में लगाए, 3 कंपनियों पे कंट्रोल रहेगा. फ्लेक्सिबिलिटी ऑफ फाइनेंसिंग, कल को मेरे पार्टनर को लेके आया कि मेरे फ्रेंड को लेके आया एज एक्विटी शेयर होल्डर, टुमारो आई कांट टेल हिम दैट माई जॉब इज डन, प्लीज गो, बट लोन यू कैन रीपे. लोन लिया, आप बैंक को बोल सकते हो आपका पैसा पकड़ो और मुझे फ्री करो. सेविंग ऑफ टैक्स, आपने देखा जब एक्विटी यूज करी है तो आपका टैक्स 36 लाख हो रहा है, और जब आपने लोन यूज किया है तो आपका टैक्स 28 मिलियन डॉलर हो रहा है, यू सेव ऑन टैक्स. बेनिफिट ऑफ डाइवर्सिफिकेशन, एक ही कंपनी है वो कंपनी डूब गई, यू आर फिनिश्ड. 3 कंपनियों में पैसा लगाया, एक डूबी, 2 कंपनी अभी भी बाकी हैं, 2 कंपनियां डूबी, 1 कंपनी अभी भी बाकी है. सो यू हैव दी बेनिफिट ऑफ डाइवर्सिफिकेशन, बेनिफिट ऑफ रिस्क रिडक्शन, हायर रिटर्न पर शेयर, ईपीएस इज हायर इन केस ऑफ योर ऑप्शन ऑप्शन 3, हायर वेल्थ फॉर शेयर होल्डर्स, जितना ईपीएस ज़्यादा होगा शेयर होल्डर्स की उतनी वेल्थ ज़्यादा होगी. हायर रिटर्न ऑन एक्विटी, आपने देखा कि रिटर्न ऑन एक्विटी इज हायर इन केस ऑफ दी लेवरेज्ड प्रपोजल. एंड सो दिस इज हाउ आर ऑल दी बेनिफिट्स ऑफ बोरोइंग फ्रेंड्स, एंड दिस इज योर फाइनेंशियल लेवरेज. प्लीज रिमेंबर दी ऑब्जेक्टिव एंड पर्पज ऑफ ऑल दी बिजनेसेस अक्रॉस दी ग्लोब फॉर द टॉप मैनेजमेंट इज टू मैक्सिमाइज योर ईपीएस. बट एट द सेम टाइम रिमेंबर, फाइनेंशियल लेवरेज इज गुड, बट एक्सेसिव फाइनेंशियल लेवरेज इज नॉट गुड. यानी कि आप बोरो करिए लेकिन एक्सेसिवली बोरो मत करिए, बिकॉज दैट कैन पुट यू इन ट्रबल. सो फ्रेंड्स, नाउ वी कम टू द लास्ट टॉपिक ऑफ द डे, एंड दैट इज योर. यस अमित,
only one question over here.
Yes, please.
Borrowing and reducing the tax and that, as you mentioned, for leveraging with other parameters, then why companies are targeting debt-free scenario?
Okay, good question. Good question, Amit. Good question. See, देखो क्या है, in the domain of finance, your strategy has to change as per the time. If you remember little while ago, I mentioned, when everything is fantastic, you try to target to earn as high a profit as possible. Situation सही नहीं है तो फिर आपको आपको खाली profit से satisfy होना पड़ेगा, और situation खराब है तो आपका objective क्या होगा कि कम से कम break even हो जाए, normal break even हो जाए. और भी situation खराब है, आपका क्या objective होगा कि कम से कम cash break even तो हो जाए. Same is the case today with the debt. Please remember, जब आप borrow करते हो अमित, when you are borrowing, you are getting cash in your business. But together with cash, you are getting two obligations. एक, आपको वो पैसा चुकाना है एक दिन, दूसरा आपको उसके ऊपर इंटरेस्ट भरना है. तो जब मार्केट बूम में है, आपकी आप यू आर एबल टू सेल प्रोड्यूस एंड सेल वॉट एवर यू आर प्रोड्यूसिंग, योर एबिटडा इज वेरी गुड, आपके पास में एबिटडा, योर ऑपरेटिंग कैश प्रॉफिट भरपूर है, तो कितना भी आपने लोन लिया आपको इंटरेस्ट चुकाने में कोई दिक्कत ही नहीं है, क्यों? क्योंकि उतना आप कैश जनरेट कर रहे हो आपके ऑपरेशन से. तो दैट इज वाई इन दो सिचुएशंस यू कैन गो फॉर द फाइनेंशियल लेवरेजिंग. टुडे व्हाट इज द सिचुएशन टुडे, बिकॉज ऑफ द पेंडेमिक, द मार्केट्स हैव गॉन डाउन, इकोनॉमी हैज गॉन डाउन, लोगों के बिजनेस के ऑपरेशन कम हो गए हैं, एंड देयरफॉर एबिटडा इज अंडर प्रेशर. ऑपरेटिंग कैश प्रॉफिट दैट यू आर द कंपनीज आर जनरेटिंग टुडे have reduced considerably, and since EBITDA is not available, how do you service the debt? हाउ डू यू एंड सर्विस, तो आपको डेट तो सर्विस करना पड़ेगा, आपने लोन लिया है तो आपको कर्जा चुकाना पड़ेगा, आपको इंटरेस्ट भरना पड़ेगा, और प्रॉफिट प्रॉफिट आपके पास में है नहीं। तो अब ऐसे सिचुएशन में आप क्या करो, डी लेवरेज करो। डी लेवरेज मतलब जो भी आपके डेट हैं आप उनको जितना चुका सकते हैं चुका दो, जो भी आपकी नॉन ऑपरेटिंग एसेट्स हैं, आइडल एसेट्स हैं, उनको डिस्पोज ऑफ करो और लोन को, लोन से फ्री हो जाओ। क्यों लोन से फ्री हो जाओ? मार्केट्स आर डाउन, इकोनॉमी इज डाउन, सेल्स इज डाउन, एबिटडा इज डाउन, कैश ही नहीं है इंटरेस्ट भरने के लिए। तो क्या कर सकता हूँ मैं आज की तारीख में, इंटरेस्ट बर्डन मेरा कम कर दूँ। एंड दैट इज द रीजन वाई मोस्ट पीपल आर टॉकिंग इन टर्म्स ऑफ रिड्यूसिंग द डेट टूडे। होप दैट आंसर्स योर क्वेरी अमित।
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, very good. Thank you, friends. So now we are at the last topic, and provision relating to availment of ITC for GST paid to the vendors. And I understand, friends, this is the case with many of the organizations. Under the GST regime, how does it work? GST is, as we all know, is a value-added tax. So you pay tax only on the value that you add. And there is a mechanism of ITC. So what is the mechanism of ITC? That is input tax credit. So when I purchase goods from my suppliers, right? So my suppliers will raise an invoice on me, and they will raise invoice on me, and in that invoice they will charge me GST of 18%, and they will give me the invoice, and I will make the payment to my suppliers of the goods that they have supplied to me, plus 18% of GST on the value of those goods. I will have to make this payment to my suppliers. What my supplier is supposed to do? My supplier is supposed to pay this GST to the government and also file a return with the government, which is online. Payment of the GST is also online. Filing of the return is also online. Now, after my supplier, my vendor, has paid the GST that he has collected from me with the government and have also filed the monthly return where he mentions that he supplied goods to various parties, customers, including me. And when he files this return and makes this payment to the government authorities, only then we as a company will be able to avail the credit of this GST that we have paid to the supplier. That means what? That means, taking a normal scenario, supplier supplied goods to me, he raised an invoice to me, I have made the payment to the supplier, supplier has paid that GST, I have made the payment to the supplier including the amount of GST, supplier has paid that GST to the government and also has filed a return with the government mentioning that he has collected so much of GST from me and that he has paid to the government. Once he does it, it automatically reflects in a GSTR return, which is GSTR 2A. Now, once he does both these things, automatically the GST that I paid to him reflects in GSTR 2A. That means now when I'm raising invoice on my dealers, I am also charging them GST, isn't it? So my dealers, when they are making payment to me, they are also making payment to me for the vehicles that I have sold to them, plus the GST that I have charged onto them. Now this GST that I have collected from my dealers, I am supposed to pay to the government, but I have the facility of availing the GST that I have paid to my suppliers as the credit. So let's say, for example, GST that I have collected is 100 crore and GST that I have paid to my suppliers is 60 crores. Okay, GST that I have collected from all my dealers all over the country is 100 crore and GST that I have paid to all my suppliers for the supplies that they have made to me is 60 crores. In the normal course, if everything goes smoothly, I have collected 100 crores from my dealers, I have paid 60 crores to my suppliers, and therefore what I have to pay to the government is not the 100 crore of GST that I have collected. I am supposed to pay only 40 crores of GST online through the GST portal. That is the normal course. Assuming that my suppliers have paid their GST they have collected from me, and they have also filed the return with the online return. Ab, if my suppliers, let's take an extreme example, all my suppliers have either they have not paid the GST to the government that they have collected from me, or they have not filed the return indicating the GST that they have collected from me and the on different invoices, they have not filed the GST return. So if either of these things they do, yani ki ya to wo paisa na bharein aur ya fir GST ka return na file karein ya fir dono hi cheez na karein, assuming that my suppliers have done either of these two things, some of the suppliers have not filed the returns, some of the suppliers have not paid the GST to the government, and therefore the credit of 60 crores that I have paid to all these suppliers is not available to me. That means what? That means as a company, I have to pay a GST of 100 crore to the government. And you can understand, when I was required to pay only 40 crore of GST, I am paying 100 crore of GST. That means I am making an excess outflow of 60 crores from my bank account. That means it is draining my working capital. And why this drain is happening? This drain is happening because my suppliers have failed in fulfilling their obligation. This is the entire scenario. And in that context, when I'm going to have this discussion with you. So what are the conditions to be satisfied for taking credit of input tax credit for the GST paid to suppliers as per section 16(2)(b). Number one, there should be a valid tax invoice, debit note, prescribed tax document, which of course I received from the supplier, there's no issue. Goods should have been received, that is also not an issue. Tax paid on such supply is actually paid to the government by the supplier. Now that is what has to happen. Number two, he has to furnish the return as per section 39. That has to happen. So these two things has to happen for me to take the benefit of the ITC, else I will not get the benefit of ITC until and unless my supplier does both these things. Aur usme bhi ek cheez yaad rakhiye ki if they fault in doing either of these two things for 1 or 2 months, it's fine. But if they stretch it and take it beyond September month of the following year, then I will not be able to get the credit of that GST that I paid to them at all. And that means it is going to hit my bottom line. And why should it hit my bottom line? Because I am not at fault as a company. Who is at fault? The suppliers are at fault. And that is where there is a need of continuous monitoring. And I have few suggestions which I am going to share with you. If goods are received in lots or installments, then ITC can be taken upon receipt of last lot or installment. So it's possible that a consignment come in different parts. So the ITC can be availed when the last of the shipment is received. So that is number one. Number two, critical steps for availment of ITC credit. Supplier to pay the GST collected from the company to the government. That's number one. Supplier to file the monthly online GST return on or before the due date. That is number two. After these two steps are done, GST credit will reflect in my company's GST electronic register GSTR2A. So the amount will, once he files the return and once he pays the amount of GST to the government, then the GST credit will automatically reflect in my electronic register. So that means now this credit is available to me. This ITC amount, the company will take credit of and pay the balance GST. So assuming that all my suppliers have paid the GST on time, what they collected from me, they have also filed the return on time. So now they have done. So this 60 crore of GST that I paid to them will reflect in my electronic register. That means when I have to pay 100 crores of GST that I have collected from my dealers, I will not pay 100 crores. I will pay only 40 crores. And why I will pay only 40 crores? Because 60 crores I have already paid through my suppliers. So this, once they do it, this amount will reflect in the GST electronic register. This ITC amount, the company will take credit of and pay the balance GST. That's 100 crore, 60 crore credit is available. So now the company will pay 40 crores as the GST liability. If either of the first two steps not completed by the supplier, ITC credit will not reflect in company's GST electronic register. Hence, it will not be available for claiming. And that is why company will have to pay 100 crores, as I said earlier. Generally, friends, suppliers comply with these obligations. So I don't think that most companies would do. Most company will fulfill their obligations because they understand it. But some companies, knowingly or unknowingly, or because of the cash crunch at their end, can result into not doing the needful. So those failing to do so need to be flagged and dealt with accordingly. So jo suppliers hamare jo ye nahi karte hain, those need to be flagged and they need to be dealt with accordingly. For example, some companies will hold the amount of koi mera supplier hai jisne do char bar aise ye kiya ki usne delay kiya, because of that I was not able to take the credit. To kuch company kya karti hain, some companies will hold the amount of GST while making payment to suppliers who have consistently defaulted in the past, and pay this amount only after the supplier has paid the GST and filed the return as a measure to put in the necessary discipline. So that is what some companies do with those suppliers who have defaulted, not with everyone. So these are your GSTR 1, which is to be filed by the supplier, and assessee with turnover of inward supplied for which credits are not reflecting in GSTR 2A will require follow-up. So whenever I made payment to my suppliers, and if those GST amounts are not reflecting in the GSTR 2A, that means follow-up will need to be done with those suppliers for doing the needful. ITC credit can be availed up to filing of the final return by the company. Final, that is annual return. Last date for the same is 30th September of the following financial year. After that, it freezes. After that, you cannot claim the credit in any case. So some companies, what they do, they issue purchase orders to suppliers with a clause that for any non-availment of ITC, credit on account of fault on the part of the supplier will be recovered from him, just to ensure that your interests are protected. So friend, this is what I thought I would share with you as far as availment of the credit from credit of the GST on account of the payments that you have made to your supplier is concerned. And friends, with this we come to the close of the session, and my sincere apology for having exceeded today's session by 1 hour. But I thought whatever we have to share and discuss, I think we should complete. So all from my side. So thank you so much to all of you for being such a wonderful audience, and always willing to interact and participate wholeheartedly, whole enthusiastically. Thank you so much. And with this, I come to the end of my session. Thank you once again to all of you, and my heartfelt thanks to Neeraj and Gajanan and Sneha for making these sessions possible. Thank you so much, and wishing you all the very best. Thank you so much. Thank you. Over to you, Neeraj and Gajanan.
Thank you, sir.